Being a Mormon for a short period of time was just the beginning of something more. Sometimes to be truly home on a spiritual journey, you will have to spend the night at temporary ones along the way.
Would you like to know how I got there? Climb aboard, find an open seat, and have your tickets ready.
I've mentioned in two of my videos a woman who not only made my 24th birthday one of the most memorable birthdays I ever had, but she was also a bright light to my existence in the fall of 2001. Allow me to introduce you to her. In the large group of people I befriended in 2000, Remy was another lady in the group I connected well with when I met her. She and I always poked fun at each other, and we made each other laugh. For Christmas in 2000, she got me the best gag gift ever. A keychain of S.J. Sharkey. If you pulled its string, it vibrated. It would be known in our circle's folklore as my vibrating Sharkey. I even got an award for having too much fun with it. Near the end of the summer of 2001, as I was still recovering from the devastating breakup with Lucy, Remy and I would begin to have our occasional cozy moments. Slowly over the next 2 weeks, it grew into something more. On September 12th, we both decided, why not? Becoming sweethearts on the day after one of the darkest days in U.S. history was merely a coincidence. A perk in all of this? Her parents were Sharks season ticket holders. Yes, we did go to a game together, albeit a preseason game. On our days and nights together, the two of us enjoyed each other's company, whether we were alone or with our friends. Sometimes I would go to her house after a long night at work and get home at around midnight. We were both college bums at the time. Burning the candle at both ends didn't faze us. During that period of time in our lives, Remy was a Catholic. Don't worry, I learned my lesson after getting snared into the Latter-day Saints. During the days we spent together, I told Remy about my period of disfellowship ending on September 23rd. She couldn't believe that I served a 5-month penance for falling short. I'm not a Catholic, but even they don't believe in that kind of punishment. One thing I didn't mention on that LDS conference Sunday in October 2001. Earlier that morning, I went to a Catholic Mass with Remy. In my childhood, my dad remarried into a very large Catholic family. I was familiar with how a Mass was conducted. I enjoyed that hour with Remy on her spiritual turf, even if I felt dirty doing so. If you watched my days as a saint, you would know that 2 weeks after that Catholic service, I walked away from the Mormons. I was free. I could work Sundays without feeling guilty. I could indulge in caffeinated drinks like Cherry Coke. I could watch whatever I wanted to. I could listen to whatever I wanted to. I could say whatever I wanted to, you son of a diddly. When the calendar turned to November, the ghost of Joseph Smith would be collecting the debt for my abandonment of the one true church. It happened on a Tuesday afternoon on November 6th. Remy and I hit the wall in our relationship. Hard. Instead of fully enjoying the blessing of having Remy by my side, Lucy continued to live rent-free in my head. It wasn't a good thing. Remy and I agreed to break it off. I'm not sure what was going through her mind at the time, but I was racked with a layer of failure. I broke her heart, and at the same time broke my own. Nothing left to do but press on, feeling a sense of emptiness that would linger on for a while. It wasn't the same vibe hanging out with my friends after the breakup. When Lucy tossed me aside earlier that year, my friends were there the next day to provide support. It was different yet awkward after Remy and I split up. But that didn't mean that we were not going to try and stay friends, right? It would be a lonely holiday season filled with work, sports ball, and mindless entertainment. A Sharks game I went to on December 11th would bring temporary relief. A thrilling contest that needed overtime and me screaming a proclamation in that OT period. I wasn't done paying the debt. For the last 5 of my 8 years working at the little mom and pop restaurant, I endured ownership changes. The original owners that hired me would sell, then end up getting the business back months later. The latter would be the case here. The guy who bought the business earlier in 2001 would throw in the towel, and that would be the end. After 6 years of working my way up from the bottom, I was tossed aside along with the rest of the staff. It would be temporary, but more on that later. I'll just chase the blues away by going to my first ever college football bowl game on New Year's Eve. Oh, the team I rooted for lost, and I had to sit with a bunch of Michigan State fans that afternoon.
5, 4, 3, 2.
Drop the ball, Dick. Maybe 2002 would be better. It wasn't, at first. The Niners lost to Brett Favre and the Green Bay Packers in a playoff game. Again. Well, it could be worse. I could have been a Raider fan that same month. For most of January, I went to school and tried to enjoy life. Seeing Remy along with my friends was a trial at times. In February, it didn't get better. It just got tolerable. The perfect distractions came along during that month. On the day after Valentine's Day, a remodel of my house would begin, and it would be a month-long project. The other distraction would be the 2002 Winter Olympic Games in Salt Lake City. Since the NHL took 2 weeks off so their players could participate, it would be at the forefront of my sports viewing life. Watching a judges scandal in pairs figure skating and the United States winning silver in men's hockey was a nice diversion. I needed closure after losing Remy. I've got it. Write out my feelings, put it in a bottle, and toss it ashore on Valentine's Day. I remember a year prior I was with Lucy having a romantic lunch in Carmel. In 2002, I would return to the town Dirty Harry once ran. I trudged down Ocean Avenue with one objective, find the beach. I didn't care if I got wet. I was going to find a rock to hold my weight. Once I found a rock to stand on, that was where I would toss the bottle into the ocean. While I walked back uphill on Ocean Avenue with wet feet, I felt a weight being lifted off my shoulders. Game over. Time to move on. No, the debt was still not paid. I met with my friends at a birthday party at Joshua's house in early March. This was the night that I slowly started to feel my soul drowning. We were all having a good time, laughing, joking around, you know, the usual merriment. Then someone, I'll call him Jim, suffered a severe asthma attack. It was so severe that he would be hauled off into an ambulance and driven to the hospital. We all followed. Gathered together in the waiting room, we would wait and hope that Jim's asthma attack wasn't life-threatening. While we waited, I saw something that was bothering me. Remy was huddled up next to another man. It was Jim's older brother, Don. Could it be a sign of compassion? At first glance, sure, why not? She was holding his hand at the end of the ordeal. I couldn't help think that something was going on between those two over the past 2 months. Maybe longer. Why should I care, right? She was a free agent, and so was I. It turns out that Jim would be okay, and we would all leave the hospital and go back to Josh's house for more birthday fun. Well, not all of us. I drove home from the hospital around 1 in the morning crying an ocean of tears. I was in denial the whole time. I wasn't over Remy. I spent the next day in a state of darkness, replaying the previous night's events over and over on Solemn Sunday. No form of mindless entertainment would take my mind off this realization. When I couldn't get excited by this, the first goal a Sharks goalie would ever score, you knew something was wrong. As mentioned earlier, my unemployment was temporary. The original owners of the restaurant took it back and reopened 2 days after that disastrous night at the hospital. There, back to work. I can just focus on work and not have to worry about the fact that Remy had moved on. Yeah, that didn't work either. The straw that broke the camel's back was a night I hung out with my friend Linus and his girlfriend, who happened to be at Remy's house. Yeah, I was a glutton for punishment. After an hour of seeing Remy leaned up against her beau, I went home, numb. I got tired of feeling this way. I sent an email to my friends to tell them what was happening to me. Inside my head, I was screaming and crying out for help. Some kind of unknown force was swallowing me alive. I asked for help, even though it all rested on my shoulders. Only two people got back to me. One couldn't do too much because she lived on the East Coast. Someone I met in the NHL chat rooms years before. The other was in our group, but she was more on the outside looking in during those days. But she at least seemed to care. She even prayed for me. While I was resistant towards prayer, I appreciated her efforts. 2 weeks after my cry for help, it wasn't getting better. Work kept me sane in a way, but I was still hurting. I would have to do something drastic to get Remy out of my system. Looking back on it over 20 years later, it was probably one of the most selfish things I've ever done. I would go into hiding. I realize it's foolish to abandon your friends because of a romance that didn't pan out well. However, at that time, I didn't know what else to do. There were times Remy tried to talk to me about what was going on with me. How do you tell someone that probably cares that you're in pain because you weren't over that same person? Any attempts of Remy trying to get in my head were met with silence or the robotic reply of nothing. So it begins, a period of my life where I had to find my hiding places on the campus. I've been around there long enough to know them all. Despite the exile from my friends, I still found reasons to get out of bed. I was making up a course I flunked out the first time and I was enjoying it with this new teacher. I started getting into the dry comedy of George Carlin and, strangely enough, the tranquil sounds of Enya. I even took in a much-needed Sharks game on April 2nd. I watched them beat the Mighty Ducks. It's happened! I would finally see the Sharks beat the Ducks when I was there! Later in April, Josh suffered an aneurysm and spent some time at the hospital. In fact, he almost died from it. How do I know? Remy told me. While I was concerned for Josh's health, my selfish subconscious was saying, why am I hearing this from her? To paraphrase Humphrey Bogart, all the people who could be bringing me this news, it had to be her. Josh would eventually recover from this ordeal after a few months. Off topic, the Sharks winning the Pacific Division for the first time in franchise history would be one of the brightest parts of my spring. Too bad they couldn't figure out Patrick Waugh and the Colorado Avalanche in the second round. As May came, my exile from the circle continued. I was invited to a birthday party to be held at the boardwalk in Santa Cruz. Nope, I got a ticket to the Sabercats game. Remy would invite everyone, including me, to her house for an end-of-the-year party, just like in 2001. I didn't even need to get a tux this time. Nope, I'd rather go see The Sum of All Fears. If my dad were still alive, he would have been disappointed by the film. I think at that point, I was going to be left alone for the summer. Hey, I did this to myself. The summer was a blur, but it did have its moments. Just like in 2001, my mom and stepdad took a trip to Reno and the house was all mine for a couple of days. I think it was time for another one-man reality show. It would be another pet project to work on during the summer. The USA did A-OK at the 2002 World Cup. I would continue to expunge the Fs I got in college as I made up another class. This time, it was marriage and family. Maybe I'd listen this time. At the end of July, I passed the class. Three more credits, another F gone. Also, I took in a Giants game. While Barry Bonds didn't hit his 600th home run that night, Rob Nen would record his 300th career save. Another fall semester would begin, and I had a few more classes to make up. One of them would pave the way for the next chapter of my spiritual journey. I would slowly make my way back into the group of friends I hid from during the summer. It would take a few weeks, and I'm sure there was a little mistrust on their part after what I did, but I'm grateful that I would eventually be accepted again. Now to the heart of this story. I was ready to find another church home, but what and where? Catholicism was out, and Mormonism was definitely out. My mom told me of a non-denominational church that I gave a chance, but still wasn't sure about. In that fall semester, I had to attend a history class in another town that met on Wednesday mornings. It was taught by a woman who taught history at Stanford. I would learn a lot of interesting things that I'd never heard in any other history class. Nothing wrong with that. I still had to buy that book of half-truism called The People's History of the United States. The good news is, it wasn't essential. If one took good notes during the lectures, the tests were simple to pass. I packed my tape recorder with me just in case I nodded off. I would take notes later on my computer. A funny thing that would sometimes happen, I would hear my own snoring not only on my own tape, but the tape of the person sitting next to me when she was recording for her own transcriptions. On the 1-year anniversary of September 11th, I would learn a new belief system that I warmed up to. One debate that goes on about these United States. Is the United States a Christian nation, or a nation that was founded on biblical values at the time? This is the equivalent of how the earth was created. Many people, myself included, believe that it was created by God. Others subscribe to the Big Bang Theory. Many of the founding fathers believed in some form of Christianity. Others, such as Thomas Paine and Thomas Jefferson, were deists. So what is deism? Deism is the belief that a supreme being created the universe, set it in motion, and bounced. A biblical example of deism would be the first two chapters of Genesis. The deity of a deist is often referred to as the great clockmaker. If you ask the deist to prove God's existence, their answer is, look around you. Look at the trees. Look at the oceans. Look at these creatures, big and small. This is all the proof you need in the existence of God. how the earth and the universe works. All of that is God's law of nature. While theists believe that God is omnipotent and intervenes, deists don't believe God intervenes on anyone's behalf for any reason. This also means that the Bible is a book and nothing more to deists. Jesus Christ the deist fall into the same category to many other religions as a great man and nothing more. Many deists believe that Jesus existed, died, and remains dead. In fact, Thomas Jefferson literally cut and pasted his own Bible known as the Jefferson Bible, rearranging the four Gospels in chronological order while eliminating anything that mentioned Mary's Immaculate Conception and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I can only imagine him awaiting judgment for this sin. Jefferson would be answering for something worse after his death in 1826. The deist usually resorts to reason to explain away anything and everything, which would come in handy in my English class that semester.
You know, you might think about taking Jesus Christ as your savior instead of fooling around with all this stuff.
No, Eddie. After getting burned by an organized religion that supposedly had Jesus Christ at its center, I'm hopping on this train. I went further down the internet rabbit hole over the next 2 days after that lecture. I liked what I read and learned about this philosophy. I screamed it in my head as if I were Lisa Simpson.
I'm a
deist. Deist.
My Satan sense is tingling.
Don't worry, Ned. Nothing lasts forever. As I approached a milestone of my existence with a new identity that would require me to approach life with a sense of rationality, why not take in a ball game? The A's lost to the Mariners, and I had a late dinner with my friends after I got back from the game. A week later, I would make a new friend. What? Oh yeah, I better get that part out of the way. During that week, I wrote what I wanted to say, addressed it to the church records office, and walked it over to the bishop of the Ensign Ward. From September 17th, 2002 on, I waited. As I was saying, on the afternoon of September 23rd, I made a new friend. She was sweet, kind, very talkative, and we hit it off immediately. We talked about many things, including our life stories and our, I guess you could say, beliefs. The day ended with me taking her to her voice class in another town. After a week of getting to know her, I figured it was time to get back on the horse. I've healed from losing Lucy, and I was doing better after the 10 months I spent picking up the pieces after Remy and I flamed out. Did I mention that this new face had a boyfriend when I met her? Well, I just did. Whenever I think about how it all began with, what name can I pull out of my hat? Okay, Emily. When I look back on how Emily and I got together, I would occasionally feel pangs of guilt. I couldn't help but wonder, did I swoop in and steal her? My loving wife would have to remind me that, hey, she chose you. In a way, she was probably right. 2 days after Emily and I met, I dropped her off at her place after keeping her protected for most of the day from her somewhat abusive partner. I put the ball in her court. If she wanted to stay with him, I would have remained her new friend and drew some boundaries. But she didn't. She broke up with him and told him to move out of the apartment her parents from afar were paying the rent on. After the dust settled, Emily went home to the East Bay to stay the weekend at her parents. September 27th was when it began. A quick backstory to this. Emily and her ex moved to my neck of the woods during the summer because he got a job in the area. Emily would eventually join my circle of friends. Until that happened, she and I spent a lot of time together, whether at school or her apartment that wasn't too far from my house. When I had a day off work, I would occasionally sneak in her afternoon class to watch a few classic movies. On Mondays, I would sit on a couch and watch her sing. She knew how to make a fabulous turkey meatloaf. In our innocent yet passionate relationship, we made sure we both stayed on track in our studies. In early December, Emma and I went to the East Bay so I could meet her parents for the first time. Her family were in the middle of celebrating Hanukkah. Oh yeah, Emily was Jewish. Being a deist at that time, I didn't care. Neither did she care that I had my own beliefs about God and used reason to explain everything away. We even got each other gifts for that night and caught a flick at the famous Ream Theater in neighboring Moraga. Although she didn't celebrate Christmas but acknowledged the holiday, Emily was more than happy to go to the annual Christmas party at Josh's house. Unlike 2001, there wasn't an awkward tone. Remy and I were cool with each other after a month-long falling out in the autumn. It was another Yuletide night of laughs and memories. What made that night stranger was Lucy made an appearance. 18 months after we split up, I had enough going on in my life that the wound she put in my heart had fully healed. 2002 ended with new love, new friends, and a new identity. Little did I know that I was standing on a trap door.